Well, you're listening to Boomertown, Canada's number one nostalgia podcast. Next, a storage locker containing hundreds of letters, photographs, and audio diaries between Johnny Cash and his manager, Saul Holiff. When we return, Barry chats with Holiff's son about his film, My Father and the Man in Black. Stay with us.
A documentary has been making the rounds for several years now, and once again we'll have an opportunity to see it as it peels back the curtain on Johnny Cash and his longtime manager, Saul Holiff. It was a partnership that saw Cash morph from troublesome addict to international superstar. But that partnership ended in the 1970s upon Holiff's suicide. With letters, artifacts, audio diaries, and recorded phone calls Holiff left behind, his son, Jonathan, has made a film entitled My Father and the Man in Black that reveals an often tempestuous relationship with Cash, a self-destructive Southern Baptist troubadour transformed into a mythic sensation.
Well, I was with him for 13 years, and I had virtually no life of my own. I gave Johnny up. Johnny didn't give me up. I don't know of any similar situation where someone gives up an act.
Johnny came out, looked at the audience, strummed the guitar once, and then he looked down and looked at Saul, and he said, "Saul, help me," in the most pathetic voice.
Well, the film, which is called My Father and the Man in Black, was made and released in 2013. And what inspired it was, unfortunately, my father's suicide, which happened in 2005. I was living in Los Angeles at the time, and we had been estranged for many years. And I decided to go home to Vancouver Island to look in on my mother at that time. And that's when I accidentally came across his storage locker, and to my surprise, several boxes of Johnny Cash material.
Wow.
Inevitably, those included 600 letters and 60 hours of audio diaries and secretly recorded phone calls with Cash.
Gee. Up to that, what did you know about this relationship?
It was pretty limited. I was 9 months old on my first Johnny Cash tour. They'd been together since 1958.
Hmm.
I was born in 1965. And by the time my father quit Johnny Cash in 1973 and ultimately retired altogether from the business in around 75, I was only 10 years old. I was certainly aware of what he did for a living, but it wasn't something that he talked an awful lot about. And so I had no detail. And so I was as surprised as many were to learn, for example, that Saul hired June and put her with Johnny, and essentially a Canadian managed Johnny Cash to superstardom, where by the end of the 1960s, he was outselling the Beatles in North America from London, Ontario.
So it was like a long-distance relationship with Johnny down in Tennessee, I guess, and your father up in Canada. How did that work? I thought he'd probably want to be a little closer to it than that, or maybe that was the best thing he could do to get away from it. I don't know. What was the...
Well, that's a good question, and your guess is not far off. Saul was on the road all the time.
Yeah.
But ultimately, Johnny invited Saul to, and our family, to move not just to Nashville, but into a home that he promised to construct right next door to his own home in Hendersonville, Tennessee. But I think you guessed right. Saul didn't want to be that close to Johnny, and he was a proud Canadian. He went around with a briefcase with not one but two Canadian flag stickers on it. And the fact that he stayed in London turned out to be a boon for Canada, because so much of the Johnny Cash story took place in Canada, including his having proposed to June on stage in London, Ontario in 1968.
That's a familiar clip, too, isn't it? I think I've seen that before. It's been registered on film.
Well, actually, that's another interesting aspect. It was not filmed in 1968. There are about a half a dozen color photographs from that show. But you're probably thinking about the wonderful recreation
oh, yeah.
in the hit movie Walk the Line. However, what's funny about that is that if you remember Walk the Line and that scene in particular, it was portrayed as a plush auditorium, not unlike, say, the Ryman Theater in Nashville. But in fact, it was the old London Gardens ice hockey rink in London, Ontario, and everyone was sitting on folding metal chairs on a plywood-covered ice rink.
Well, we can get back to the narrative on the Hollywood version just a little later on, but this sounds like it's a film that deals with, I guess, two flawed men, both Johnny and your father. Can you talk a little bit about this? Your father was intermittently cruel and withholding. You describe him as an alcoholic sometimes. Can you talk about that as well?
Absolutely. This is a critical look at both men who were, you know, often in conflict with each other and who were both deeply flawed and deeply troubled. So this is a no-punches-pulled portrayal of the two men, but it really is driven by an exploration of mine to get to know this father who I had been estranged from and who had committed suicide without leaving a note. So to that extent, it's both a one-of-a-kind behind-the-scenes look at Johnny Cash in the 1960s and 70s, but it's also a universal story about fathers and sons.
We're talking with Jonathan Holiff now, who is the son of the manager for Johnny Cash for so many years, Saul Holiff. Do you blame the relationship with Cash on your father's suicide, by the way?
No, completely unrelated. But a lot of people ask whether I blame Cash for my relationship with my father, and no more, say, than anybody else who was, you know, jealous of one or the other parent's job that took them away from home and so on. But no, the one had nothing to do with the other.
Mm-hmm. The film that you're making now and your involvement in it, is this a sort of a bit of a closure for you too?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, again, most people have these challenges in life, and I'm very grateful to have the medium of a film or television to explore these subjects and to kind of work out the and you know, have a cathartic experience in the process.
I'm wondering how a man could continue to put up with that kind of abuse from his client for so long. He just seems like he came back and and I'm sure they must have split up several times in their relationship. I'm sure that Johnny decided he was going to quit, or Saul. Did that happen?
It did. There were at least three other occasions when they parted ways, but the final death knell was in 1973. And, you know, it's a good question. A better question might be, you know, why would anybody walk away from $1 million? You know, and that's what Saul did. He walked away from a lot of money because he wanted to rebuild his self-esteem and his self-respect. And, you know, I look at the 1960s and wonder why he didn't do it then, because there was a lot of insanity in that decade. But it took Johnny's, you know, conversion to fundamentalist Christianity. He was born again and made kind of a hard right turn in his life and career that unfortunately saw his career go downhill for the next 20 years. And Saul saw the writing on the wall, and he resigned.
Talking with Jonathan Holiff, the son of the manager for Johnny Cash, I guess we got to go back and compare this narrative with, as you say, the Hollywood version, Walk the Line. Can you comment on that? How did this compare, do you think?
I loved the movie. I enjoyed it thoroughly. And it deserved all of the accolades. But having said that, you're right. The fact is that when you make a two-hour movie out of a 30-year career, or an entire lifetime in Johnny's case, you have to compress the timeline and
yeah.
You have to combine events. And at the end of the day, you get kind of a sense of what was going on, but not the reality. And I was very gratified that a number of reviewers of my movie called it the nonfiction Walk the Line. So if you want to know the true stories behind that hit film, go and rent or whatever, stream My Father and the Man in Black. It's available anywhere you watch films except, unfortunately, Netflix. It's on Amazon, iTunes, Sundance Now. Everywhere you look, you'll find it.
Wow. Yeah, I'm sure you are. The letters and the artifacts and the diaries and all of that stuff, is there still work to be done?
Yes. Well, let me put it this way. It took, it took roughly 5 years to research, write, and make the film. We recently, as a family, donated all of it to the University of Victoria. So I'm pleased to say that anybody, you don't have to be an educator or a researcher, can call up the library at UVic and go and see the collection for yourself.
Wow. Jonathan, thank you so much for joining us on Boomertown. You've revealed a lot about your father that a lot of people, I'm sure, don't know. But, boy, I'm telling you, that connection with the University of Victoria, I'm sure a lot of people will be up there looking for that as well. Thanks for joining us today.
It was my pleasure. Thank you.
God's gonna cut you down. Tell them that God's gonna cut you down. Tell them that God's gonna cut you down.
I just couldn't believe it. I love the opening.
Very dramatic documentary.
Holy smoke. I think all of you should watch it. I really do. I thought it was amazing.
It just begs the question, how long can someone put up with that with your client before you just have to just say, you know, walk away from it, which is what he did.
Wow.
What I found, it was sad for Jonathan, obviously, but yeah. At the same time, kind of cathartic for him, you know, pull back the curtain and
that's
share
right.
his story.
Mm, yeah.
And donated the collection to our
Victoria.
Own library.
Yeah.
I mean, I think we should all go have a little boo.
Yep.
Why not?
You're right. Well, we're not done yet. Halloween is fast approaching, and when we come back, Barry chats with actor Jason Stevens and his one-man show, Frankenstein.